My video on Dr. Stella Immanuel has been banned. If you don't know what this is all about, last week, a group of doctors led by Dr. Stella Immanuel held a press conference in DC where they talked about hydroxychloroquine and COVID. Video of that press conference quickly went viral, but then it was taken down by Facebook and YouTube. On Thursday, I published a video fact-checking some of Dr. Stella Immanuel's statements, but 24 hours later, my video was also taken down by YouTube for violating community guidelines. So today, I'm going to try to address this whole hydroxychloroquine controversy. I think we can make sense of this, and hopefully in a way that doesn't violate YouTube rules so the video stays up longer than 24 hours. Otherwise, Dr. Immanuel and I are basically turning YouTube into Snapchat. The content stays up for a couple hours, and then it's gone forever. So if you want to watch my content, you better click that notification as soon as it pops up on your phone, because who knows how long it's going to last. Get it while it's hot. So let's start by trying to understand how can we have such different opinions on this. We all have a tendency to dismiss opinions that are different from our own. Someone with a different view is either corrupt or stupid. And this is much easier than actually evaluating the arguments. The media is guilty of this. They did it to Dr. Stella Immanuel. Much of the coverage focused on her supernatural beliefs. And the implication there is that because she holds these unorthodox views, then her scientific opinions should also be paid no attention. But of course, regardless of what she thinks about demons, she could be right or wrong on the science. But Dr. Immanuel is also guilty of this sin of dismissing dissenting views. In her press conference, she clearly said that studies finding no benefit of hydroxychloroquine must be fake science, her own words. And I got a taste of that medicine as well. Many viewers who saw my now banned video and disagreed with me commented that I must be on Big Pharma's payroll, I'm not, or that I just want people to die, I don't, or that I'm possessed by demons. Okay, that one maybe. So if we want to have a shot at understanding anything, we have to stop doing this. It's uncomfortable to examine an opinion that differs from mine because it forces me to examine my own. But it's the only way forward. The reality is that when you have two people with very different opinions, especially if they're both professionally qualified in the topic, it's often not the case that one is just corrupt or an idiot. Usually they're basing their views on different sources, hence the disagreement. And I think the same thing is happening here with hydroxychloroquine. Now, I know there's a lot of discussion around using hydroxychloroquine alone versus in combination with other drugs and early versus late. We're gonna try to touch on all of that, so bear with me. Unless, of course, YouTube takes down this video before you're done watching. Possible. Come on, YouTube, leave this one up. So I'll try to lay out the evidence as clearly as I can and define what we know and what we don't know yet. Because in science, there are often gray areas. Areas of uncertainty. And it's okay to say we don't know this yet. So let's get into it. Quick analogy. Let's say I want to find out if playing video games makes me more coordinated. I can ask if gamers are more coordinated, but maybe more coordinated people choose gaming more often because they do better. So what I need to do is take a group of volunteers and ask half of them to game for a period of time and then look and see if their coordination improved. The same thing happens with drug studies. I can ask if people who were given hydroxychloroquine alone or in combination did better. But maybe they were given the drug because they had different symptoms or different presentation or different risk factors, or they were treated by different doctors. It's too many maybes and it makes it hard to be sure that the difference is due to the drug. Scientists call this an observational study because I'm just observing. I'm not deciding who gets the drug and who doesn't. And it's interesting data. We take it on board. We don't dismiss it, but we interpret with caution. If we want to be sure, we gotta do the gamer experiment. We take people, we split them randomly, that's important, into two groups. One gets the drug, one doesn't. Then we see how they do. This is called a randomized control trial. Randomized because we split them randomly, controlled because we have a control group that didn't get the drug. All other things being equal, RCTs give us more confidence because they eliminate many confounders. It's very common to see results in observational trials that later don't pan out in RCTs and turn out to be unreliable. This is why RCTs are often referred to as the golden standard of evidence. Here's a real-life example to illustrate all of this. This study was published just this weekend. COVID patients treated with hydroxychloroquine had lower mortality than patients who didn't get the drug. But it was an observational study. And now you know what that means. We interpret with caution. As this article explains, the group that received hydroxychloroquine might have fared better because they were healthier to begin with and received more aggressive treatment. The patients who were given hydroxychloroquine had fewer risk factors for heart disease. Also, the hydroxychloroquine patients were more than twice as likely to be given steroids, a treatment known to be effective against COVID-19. The article goes on to explain The study was not a randomized clinical trial, which is considered the gold standard in medicine and helps avoid these potential biases. In such trials, patients are randomly assigned to take a drug or not take it, which means the two groups should be very similar. So the take-home message is that we look at all the evidence in context. We don't jump to a conclusion from individual studies. And we are especially cautious with observational studies. While everything else being equal, RCTs allow more confidence. By the way, if I see 500 patients in my clinic and I give them the drug and they do well, that's valid information. But it would rank below the observational studies because there's no control group. There's nothing to compare it to. So, all of this nerd talk allows us to understand a lot of the talking past each other that we see out there regarding hydroxychloroquine. Some people point to an observational study and say, look, there's an effect. Why is everybody ignoring this? It must be pharma money, or they must all be incompetent, or they're lying. They're right. There is an effect. And it's not being ignored. It's being looked at in the context of all the evidence. By itself, it doesn't prove efficacy until we have that RCT data. We'll see what all of this means for real-world actions and decisions in a minute. Bear with me. Now let's look at the triple combo, what everybody wants to see. Hydroxychloroquine plus an antibiotic, like azithromycin, plus a supplement, like zinc. The RCTs published so far look mostly at hydroxychloroquine alone, or with azithromycin, but not the triple combo. So a lot of people have said, okay, fine, hydroxychloroquine hasn't worked in the RCTs, but maybe the triple combo does. And that's a fair point, and observational studies suggest a benefit. What about RCTs? They're not out yet. There are ongoing studies like this one, for example, in New York, which is estimated to wrap up later this year. So, real quick, let's summarize what we do and do not know, and then let's look at what we can do with all this information. We know hydroxychloroquine alone or combined with azithromycin has shown mixed results in observational trials, with some suggesting a benefit, as we saw earlier, and others not. But the randomized control trials, the RCTs, have not supported a benefit in the conditions that have been tested. We don't know if other conditions work or other combinations. It's possible. For the triple combo, we're like halfway down the road. The observational evidence seems encouraging, and the RCTs are coming. I'm definitely curious. So we can discuss the triple combo, we can hypothesize about it, we can look at the observational evidence, we can advocate for more studies, all great. And if anybody says, we know hydroxychloroquine doesn't work, period, in any combination, in any context, we just know it. That's not true, and it can't be taken seriously. But it's just as misleading to say that hydroxychloroquine works or to call it a cure. The data does not support those statements. Now, what should we do with all this information? Separate question. David Katz from Yale just published a short video where he makes a very interesting point. I don't agree with everything he says on there, and that's okay, but he makes some very reasonable arguments. Hydroxychloroquine has side effects, just like any other medication. Cardiac issues have been reported. Now, people argue the rate. Is it high? Is it low? Fine. There is a risk. Katz's argument, which has also been voiced by Harvey Risch, also from Yale, is that there may be a point at which the potential benefits outweigh the risk. Where that line is exactly is very hard to say, but he gives the example of someone at high risk for COVID, someone of advanced age, maybe with another condition like heart disease or cancer or immunosuppressed, and who has been exposed to the virus and who is caught early on after that exposure. So the argument is that the high risk of COVID for this individual might justify running the risk of hydroxychloroquine, specifically taken in that triple combo, and taken early because that seems to be an important factor. While for someone at low risk of COVID, someone young with no diseases, it might not be worth the gamble. And this is a decision that would be made case by case between a patient and his or her doctor. It's not handing it out at the car wash. So I think that's a very reasonable point he makes, and I don't see a contradiction there. We can acknowledge that we don't know for sure if the drugs have a benefit, because the gold standard data isn't in yet, while at the same time deciding that the gamble may make sense medically for this individual. There's no contradiction. It's a decision with lots of uncertainty. That's life. But notice the monumental difference between all these qualifications and nuance and blanket statements that it works or it's a cure. One is insightful and reasonable and an interesting discussion, and the other is very hard to take seriously. Now, we're not discussing what you can and cannot do. That's not my job, and it's not the goal of this channel. We're discussing scientific evidence, what we know and what we don't, and what makes medical sense. nothing else. Also worth bearing in mind, when we look at an issue too close, we can miss the big picture. For example, many countries that squash the virus consistently cite widespread testing and contact tracing as keys. So why are we paying so little attention to those factors? We can keep studying drugs while at the same time implementing measures that have been shown to work in other countries. Why does it have to be one or the other? Why does everything have to be black and white and left versus right? We have to spend less time fighting and insulting each other over differences of opinion and more time and energy fighting the common enemy, which is this biatch of a virus.